Last night, and when I told her this part, she went, and then began to make her own fabric to sew with. She wove her way through graduate school, a PhD in clinical psychology from the University of California at Los Angeles, and she subsequently managed to transport her 54-inch loom literally around the world as jobs and life took her from New Zealand to Alaska. Her training in textiles came from girls, young women, and old women all over the world who taught her different ways to weave, spin, and sew. And while she learned and watched, she created personal connections with strangers and then realized that making textiles and clinical psychology weren't necessarily two separate undertakings, that textile making activities are a natural bridge from inner psychological issues to outer social lives, and those can be used to explore key issues. We are very excited to hear more about this topic and feel very honored to have Dr. Collier here with us today. Please join me in welcoming her.
Tying knots, embellishing, and surface design. You can dye it, you can remove color, or you can use any combination of those, which I often do many different combinations of those myself. And just to kind of get on the same page, you know, we have items that are functional, items that are non-functional. My guess is the majority of you make items that are functional. So non-functional would be making something just because it's more a work of art, and not because it's something like a piece of clothing or something that you can use. It's practical, so I'll show you some examples of non-functional pieces. And we can make vessels with them, in addition to household objects, for play, for sport. And when you get into the high-tech field of really textiles, you could be making fabrics for all kinds of transportation devices, which probably most of us have nothing to do with. These are some examples, though, of how, as I've been thinking over the years, challenging myself to not just do what I'm used to doing. So this is an example of a friend who's a potter, where I've added basketry onto the pot, which makes it non-functional for water, essentially. But that's part of what I want to talk about today. As I talk to people about using fibers for more exploration, they don't always have to be functional, and I think that's part of the challenge that people get stuck in. This is a piece, and I'll talk about one of the artists in my book. These are little tiny babies on doilies, crochet doilies, and after I met several of these artists that I talk about in my book, I mostly just wanted to raid their closets to see what they had. So, where did you get this? So I tried to interview these people and find out stuff. You don't have to read this whole thing, but you've seen this before, 10 good reasons to buy fabric. Let's see, that's what my favorites are. Buy it before your husband retires and goes with you all on shopping expeditions. Because when he does it, it doesn't hurt him. It's our duty to protect the job of people in textiles. You don't have to cook it and enjoy it. You can enjoy it. You never have to feed it, burp it, change it, work it, snows. All of those things are reasons that textile making has become just my lifesaver throughout my life. It's been just an area of my world that I can make things that are pretty, that I have control over, that I can finish. And as I started doing my research on this, a lot of people had the same responses. So you heard mostly about me, so I don't have to go back into it. And basically, all the last 4 or 5 years is when I really started thinking about, can I combine these two more academically, look at how we can look at research. There's very little research out there on this whole topic. So that's an example of a piece I did recently. And just by chance, I met a woman who's a fashion designer, and so I made the fabric. This is the backside, there's a shirt and pants, and then this is the jacket. And this material right here is from sari material that's antique, and ripped it up and put it in. So, you'll see I have a lot of different things that I do, but part of it, I think, is beginning to push yourself to try new things and experiment if you make textiles, because I think that's part of where your own growth as well as enjoyment can develop even more. And that's just this is actually one of the very first pieces I made with a workshop. And if you love the kind of textiles I make, the woman's name is Polly Sterling. She lives in Australia, and she teaches the most amazing workshops. It's really hard to get one from her these days because she's retired, but when she comes back to the U.S., she usually teaches like a 4 or 5 day workshop afterwards. So let me know if you're interested. So what motivated me to write the book? There's all kinds of anecdotes in the literature and media that everyday making textiles we call the flight. I mean, it's just something that you read about, you hear about, and you know that you do. We're comfort keepers, so just textile words, metaphors, and idioms are everywhere. And so when I started researching this, it was amazing how much part of our vocabulary it is in the English language. Spinning a tale, a thread of discourse to come unraveled, unveiling the techniques, interwoven lives, and it goes on and on, how many metaphors we use already. And so it's very rich with these metaphors. And because of that, I think that it can naturally reflect our inner psychological world and social lives. And so I think that, I'll talk about this less directly as I go through this today, but why do you choose the colors that you choose to knit with or to live in? Why do you have certain materials you like to work with? And what does it mean? And maybe, there's no direct answer for that, but maybe there is. And one example I have in my book is a coat that I made. I was living in Micronesia with my husband, and we came back home on our way before we moved to New Zealand because I had a miscarriage, and I hadn't had children yet, so this was my first pregnancy and a miscarriage. And still get them, I'm sure those of you that have gone through this, it's terrible, it's hard to talk about. But I was making a coat, and I was making a coat with fabric my brother bought in Scotland, and I was just obsessed with this. My mother-in-law is trying to do stuff, and you know, busy, and my mother-in-law is very close to me, and she's an avid fiber artist, and I basically think that what attracted me to my husband was his mother at first. And we stayed that way all the way through, because she just loves to make stuff, and so we just kind of partners in crime. But she wouldn't give me her time, and I was ripping things out and making mistakes, and the bottom line is that I have this coat, it's huge, it's beautiful, and I never wear it. And it took me years to realize what was tied up in that coat and how reflective that was in my process at the time, that I wanted some big safe cocoon that was fuzzy, I wanted my mother-in-law to engage me with it because I was so sad and overwhelmed from the miscarriage, and I could get mad at her for not coming and helping me sew things, but I couldn't get mad at her or my mother or anybody directly for losing the baby. But I think that we all have things like this in our lives, that we make things and it captures the moment and it captures the process of what we're going through. And so part of what I have said in the book and talk about is making those more conscious, thinking about that, being aware of it, and maybe using it a little bit differently. The last chapter of my book, I basically came across these amazing artists who made things, and they were psychologically minded. This piece is called Gray Ghosts, and maybe this is something we would throw away if we made, and she sees sculptural qualities in these. And I really love this woman. Her name is Rebecca Cross. She does this beautiful work with dyeing with silk. But again, it just really you kind of look at it, and it's like ugly and beautiful at the same time. And that's part of it, is thinking about the metaphors and fibers. So let me give you an example with felt. And this is what I do in the book, is I talk about how we have all these different kinds of fiber arts. What are the metaphors? What does the word mean? And then how can we, and what is the objects we make, and how do all those metaphors combine? So the word felt means, it's basically matted or compressed animal fibers. It also means to feel, which is why I love the fact that there's a metaphor that a psychologist got involved in making felt before she even realized what she was doing. So as a mental health provider, I'm concerned with feelings, and also matting the feelings into confusion. So there's just a lot of overlap between what felt means and the matting of materials, the matting of ideas. How is it made? It's basically non-woven fabrics where the fibers are locked together with heat, moisture, and compact material. So these are just different examples of types of felt that I made. This is called laminate. And you know, I do make stuff, and I do want to emphasize that I don't sell I make stuff because I have to. I don't have to emotionally for my own well-being. And I sell occasionally, but I'm just trying to show you the variety of types of things you can do with it. I'm not promoting sales of my fiber artists. I realized a long time ago that I'd never get rich, even if I write a book, but not in making my fiber arts, it's just my love, that's what I do. This is another example where you just have pure wool together without any fabric. A lot more of my pieces have fabric. And this is an example of needle felt. And where you can make the fibers go together with heat and slow pressure, as well as you can needle felt them and using barbed needles to push them into wool. So there's quite a variety of things you can do with felt, and that's part of what I love about that medium. Let's see. And then my biggest love is this thing called Nuno felt, which is what I'm wearing. And basically, Nuno felt involves putting wool onto silk, onto a very lightweight fabric. But what's interesting to me is that it has a scar-like appearance sometimes, where the material is transparent, lines run through it. And I think there's something really amazing in the metaphor of what is a scar, because scars are ways that our body heals itself when you've had something that has harmed you, but it can become really tough and it can become a problem in and of itself because it can be so fibrous. And yet, at the same time, without scarring, we wouldn't heal. And psychologically, I think that that's rich with metaphors as well, because emotionally, we get hurt over the course of our lives, and we can get really tough, we can get really sensitive, but all of those things are captured in the same metaphor. And so the types of workshops that I do and talk about in the book as well would then embrace this concept of scarring and thinking about how can we transform that into something positive. So that's an example of Nunnefeld. That's another example of Nunnefeld. Now, I don't think that I'd wear that, but I think it's pretty interesting, and it really captures for me the ultimate in the scarring quality. This is the same person who looks like Essie. My dog ate a whole ball of wool, and what happened? The puppies were all born like sputters in some yard. We should put jokes in, so we can blame them later for it. This is a piece that I made. It's on the one hand really beautiful, which is a Nunnefeld piece, but it also kind of looks like scars also. I mean, so maybe not if you ever see me wearing it, but I think this is beautiful, but I really think that it captures, again, there's these metaphors involved in fibers that we make that capture a lot of interesting, important concepts. Let's see. Okay. So I'll do a brief example of knitting. So what does to knit mean? And again, I'll go through each of these in the book and look through the English language. It means to make a garment by intertwining yarn or thread in a series of connected loops by hand with knitting needles or a machine. Have you guys seen any of the yarn bobbing things? It's very cool. Yarn bobbing or gorilla knitting. I think maybe we should do some type of urban knitting here in Eau Claire.
There's a tree. There are trees.
Where? Here? Up on Putnam Pike. I did not know that. Yeah. Oh, I'll have to go look at that. And so then in the English language, one's brow, there's sayings like cast pearls before swine, but all of these, from a psychological perspective, I think that they play a role in what fiber arts mean in our lives, because we know these things intuitively, because we've heard them many, many times in terms of knitting. So it means not to waste something precious or time-consuming on something who will not value it. Don't give somebody something that's hand-knit unless they're going to really appreciate it. This is another example of just knitting. I call this knitting world piece, so it's just another piece that I made with Nunnefeld. I didn't do anything with Nunnefeld, and I'm not a figurative artist, but I was doing so many workshops with my kids' school that I thought, I'm going to do this when I'm not around all these kids trying to keep them from poking themselves with these needles. And then I started really liking doing it, so that's kind of a side thing that I do. So metaphors, knitting can be metaphors for life, like the opening quote from Harry Class. Creating something out of available material. This is something that someone brought up in another lecture that I was giving that is fundamentally part why I got involved with weaving. Is there's just something really basic about knowing that I can make my own yarn from scratch and then weave it into fabric that can clothe me. There's just something really archetypal about that for me, where I feel like I'm connecting with women before me and making cloth. Project or idea is beginning to come together, or it's unraveling. That's another good example of words that we've incorporated into our language. What is this metaphor? And the thing about metaphors, we don't need to put any words to what's in it. We know what's in a metaphor. I like that picture. Okay, policeman stops woman and knitting at the same time. He drives up and shouts, "Pull over!" "No!" she shouts back. So I started doing research about why do women make textiles, the first study that I did, and these are in order of what women reported. I had a sample of about 950 women, probably about 150 came from Wisconsin, because I started here with people that I knew, and so I don't have any who participated in the study. And a lot of women said the aesthetic love of textiles, because it's beautiful and it's part of who I am, part of what I do, gives me a really important way to express myself. Then they said it was grounding quality, and that's everything from the repetition and the rhythm of making things like knitting or weaving with a loom. Psychologically fulfilling was third, for me, probably first, it was third, which, and that includes the joy in giving to others. By itself, and then social connections was part of the reason, because people belong to groups, they have something in the past, but that is obviously a way that a lot of women is not in the past. Okay, good. So it's not, you need to bring it back more. Another thing was intellectual stimulation, and I'm actually looking more into this in the study that I have going on now, which is because it's exciting and interesting and keeps your brain energized. And there's actually a study out of Rochester, the Mayo doctor, who found it knitting along with a few other mentally active type activities, including Sudoku, actually were related to having lower signs of Alzheimer's and dementia, as we were looking for. So it actually was protective of women as they aged to be doing stuff like that, which I love because so much of this is just not seen by people as art or seen as just women's work. So I love the fact that we're protecting our brains in really good ways. And one thing that a lot of people put down is no idle hands. And, you know, that's that. How many of you would say that's the reason you make things? It's not to have idle hands, you want to be doing something. So I think that that's true for people as well, a lot of people as well. So why are textile effective media for psychological inspiration? Well, part of this book is written for art therapists and for people who use that this type of approach in therapy. And that's important, but I will tell you that there's a lot in there that is not for professional mental health people. But people know how to use it, and I always found this really uncomfortable to me that a lot of times art therapists or people will go in and they'll say, you know, here, let's do some drawing and express how you're feeling and put it on paper, but most people that don't know how to draw are really uncomfortable and they don't like that. It doesn't feel right. And yet, if I connect with people that are knitting or that are quilting and already do that, and then we talk about ways that we can expand what they use and make to explore things, that's a whole much easier way for people to start to approach using art and the metaphor. So also, a lot of women already use it this way, but maybe they're not aware that they do. So the coat is another example. There's one example I told you about. Another, which if you read the book, you'll see in the intro, I talk about a very close friend of mine died this summer, and I knit in personal, I crocheted the piece the whole way through. And it helped me to cope. It gave me something to do while I sat there while she had a stroke and she couldn't talk. And you know, she knew that it gave me something to do so I wasn't too restless. But then all my feelings, my memories went into that piece. And I'm not alone. I know that because people told me about this in my research, that we all have things that we do, whether we gift it to somebody, we make it in a time of distress for them because we don't know what else to do for them. Or whether it's because we need something to do and it captures how we're feeling at the time. They're a way to bring people together, as well as they relax, invigorate, and rejuvenate. So, this is a quote that one of my artists in the book gave me. I was so stupid, I didn't get it. I can see now what a profound effect making this had on her. I respect her now and truly undervalue her work. And this is from a very snobbish fellow that was an architect, about a large box of crocheted doilies he found after his mother died that nobody had seen or used. And I have been obsessively collecting doilies for quite some time. I'm like, we fight you. If you find me in a hospital, you try to get another one. I don't really know what I'm going to do with them. I do incorporate that into my work. But there is this quality because the people who make these beautiful little pieces and nobody knows who they are, but they spent time in their lives making something that was really special. And another artist I met also talked about how sad it is that our art form becomes dust eventually, because it does disintegrate eventually, but there's so much passion and love and feelings and life we'll never know that go into the making of these things. So in my research, basically I found, I asked women, do you use textiles to help you to cope with life, in what I call the psychological perspective to repair mood? And if not, what else do you do and how effective is it? And basically what I found is that the women who used it that way were doing better psychologically than the women who didn't. So if you said to me instead, I went for a walk, you know, I took I went and exercised, I took a shower, other things we can all do, small things we can do to cope with life. The people who used their fiber arts that way actually psychologically had way more successful mood change at it. So I basically say that shows us. Now I've gone on, there were flaws in the study in terms of how I ask things, and I have another data set that I'm analyzing now, but it's still very consistent. And one of the things people pointed out, which I have to agree, is that, you know, if you're profoundly depressed or you're in a really severe state of grief, you can't do anything because you can't think very clearly. And I think that there's stages in our lives where, you know, how deep is that sad feeling or that anxiety, that it's not necessarily going to be helpful. And so I think the way I asked people that didn't originally get at that quality of it. That's a piece I made that I love because it's contemplative. And I made it for my psychiatrist husband, just so you know, he won't put it in his office because it's too sad. So I give him a hard time and I put it in my presentation. But again, it was like, well, why can't we make something that's sad? And for me, it was very expressive for me to try to make something that was contemplative and sad that wasn't necessarily depressing. And so, you know, that was just, these are some of my own personal challenges that I've done over the years as I've tried to explore my own way of coping with life. My other research without textiles shows that any leisure activity that's energizing, absorbing, and engaging age rejuvenation and repair. There's a few words in here I just want to explain because they really capture what's important to me in terms of, as a psychologist, what's happening here. First of all, I have taught more people than you want to know how to use relaxation techniques and made the little tapes and showed it to them. They take it home and they practice it. They come back and I say, did you practice it? I'm sorry, I'm standing outside. It might make it harder to see myself bump around a little bit more. And they practice it, and then about a month later, they're not doing it anymore. Well, how come you're not doing this? Well, it's okay, it's good, but I don't know. So they don't do it. And I don't do it either. I know how to use self-hypnosis. I know how to use relaxation because I've trained people in years on how to do this. Well, I'm a very high-energy person, and I tend to be more on the anxious side. I mean, I'm not comfortable with my anxiety, but when I get upset, it's going to be expressed more anxiety. I can tell you, even though the literature does show if you relax, that's going to help you, it doesn't really help me because I won't do it. So how's it going to help me? And so this idea that if it's energizing, that's a good thing. And in fact, maybe we don't need things that are just going to calm us down and mellow us. Maybe we need to channel that energy into something active, where we make something. And so that is actually one of the key things that I'm defining in my research. Absorbing is another quality. Now, this is something, if any of you are familiar with the idea of flow by Csikszentmihalyi, and he's talked about the sports. So engaging and absorbing are important. But I really emphasize energizing. And I'm not just interested in mood repair. I'm interested in rejuvenation, because to me, it's more than just, I go like what I call my studio, which is, it's really not a studio, but it's my studio. I go in my space and I make stuff, and then I feel like I've got perspective. And it's not because I sat there and I figured out what I was going to do about my childhood pestering me or what I was going to do about something at work that was distressing me. It's because I forgot about all that. I got involved in something and some kind of reset button was pushed in my brain. And I felt ready to just go at it again. And I often feel from my fiber making the sense of being restored, like, okay, life is good again. And I'm not really sure that it's the same as being positive mood change. It will lead to me being in a better mood, but it's not just about mood. It's about feeling that sense of rejuvenation. And so I have found from my research, I've done some work with another colleague in the psychology department here, Dr. Ron Crowley, but basically lead on this, and I have found that it's the rejuvenation quality that leads to making us feel better. And so that is what I think we find in our fiber arts. I also have found the more arousing the activity is, then the more likely it's going to lead to rejuvenation and mood repair. In fact, people told me that weaving and quilting were the most arousing and engaging. And they're probably the most, at every level, intellectually involved. Now, my guess is that those of you who make things, even within one type of thing you make, there's variations. I have knitting projects that I don't have to think about and I can just knit, and those are more relaxing to me. At times that's what I need, versus other times when I'm going to be involved in making something more complicated. So there's got to be time and a place for everything. But the less arousing activities, the least arousing was spinning. Knitting was somewhere in the middle in terms of how people reported it. Basically, excitement about fibers, mentally challenging, engaging projects, and even the movement all appear to be good. One group that people, for your mental health, One other thing to just tell you that people mentioned in my survey of about 1,000 people was just the process of planning your next project is actually exciting and leads to mood change. I see people nodding their heads. And that could be, people said that could be going out to the yard store and seeing what Daisy has at Yellow Dog. It could be getting online and looking to see. It could be looking at your stash. It could be pulling out the projects you wanted to do. But that is part of it. And it again captures this quality of your mind goes somewhere else and you really have kind of put yourself in a different place and kind of grounded yourself in a lot of ways. Okay, so what I do in the book is I talk about textile making at a different level, and it's basically building and constructing metaphorical objects. In order to explore issues in more depth. So there's two processes I'm talking about. The one is the making of it, which you already know and you already do. And the second is, can you challenge yourself and think about making something different than you've done in the past to allow yourself to use it a little differently? Okay? And that's what I'll talk about. This is, I call this Hestia. It's really kind of ugly, but at the same time, I don't care because I'm not trying to sell it. Hestia is a really good example of the unknown goddess, and I did have a lot of fun looking for images in our different variety of cultures. We call them archetypes, but essentially symbols throughout different cultures that really capture different issues. And Hestia is the invisible goddess. People don't know a lot about her, and she basically represents to me the invisible woman that goes about her life during the child-caring years or other times, where you are basically just that person in the background, but you're doing all the work all the time. So, and I do love a lot of the metaphors for bringing that out. So this, she's kind of popping out there. So it provides a range of textile-based projects that are tailored to issues that women experience. Now, yes, men can get a lot from this, and men can use textiles, and they do use textiles, particularly more so outside of the U.S. than in the U.S. But I did make a choice purposely to focus on women's issues in my book because I think there's some very significant women's issues that we experience throughout our lifetime because of our reproductive cycles alone. And everything, I just saw an article in one of the online newspapers last night about body image and the objectification of women and the fact that the media tells us how beauty plays such an important role and the impact it's had on women all throughout. Now we know this happens all throughout until we die in terms of if we've had problems with eating disorders, it doesn't go away necessarily. And so these are the kind of issues that I bring up in the book because I think these kinds of issues are important to women. And I'm sure that I could do a book like that for men, but anyways, therefore I focused on women in this book. So in the book there's a lot of matching in one particular chapter of psychosocial issues with archetypes, metaphors, myths, symbols, and fiber materials. It's not a formula book. I was very careful not to do that. I wanted it to be an idea book. Okay? So there is a natural pairing of psychological issues, and I'll give you an example in a minute, of textile metaphors with topical metaphors and object metaphors. Because when you think about it, the object of a vessel has metaphors in and of itself when you think about just a vessel. But then if you add to it the material you use, whether it's felting material, whether it is basket material, whether it's ceramics, those have metaphors in them as well. So there's metaphors in every level that are occurring. And I really emphasize to people who look at this book that I'm very aware that people come from different backgrounds in terms of religious perspectives, in terms of spiritual beliefs, disability, disability that changes over our lifetime even as we age, previous expertise and issues. I also incorporate in the book ideas about how to use guided imagery and expressive writing in exploration. So you can't see this. I mean, you couldn't. This is an example I can see to tell you, like childbearing, fertility issues. Because I have one of these is Guanyin Chinese book to Vita, childless woman. Pray to for help and compassion, and there's Xtel, the weaver of life cycle, and then the object to make is a vessel with felt or basketry, and then all the different things that are associated with that. So I talk about ideas for projects in the book. So I'll give you a quick example. What is with, and this is a workshop that I'm going to be doing in April at Unitarian Church, but that's called Crafting Healing Shawls. Now, prayer shawls are another thing altogether. And what's interesting, just so you know, because some of you are probably thinking this, women in the book, a lot of them wrote to me and said, I mean, from my research study, I don't make things for people and put my negative feelings into it because that goes, is the opposite of what I would do, let's say, for a prayer shawl. So if you're creating a prayer shawl for somebody and you want to create something with a very positive, good feeling, there's a sense that giving somebody a negative feeling that might have been your own in it could be destructive or not good for them. And I respect that. Although I don't, I think that was a subgroup of people from my study. Most people felt like it was a whole host of feelings they experienced when they made things. So the shawl, like my shawl here, the shawl metaphor in and of itself is something to embrace, to envelope, to wrap, shelter, give us comfort, just like my coat was, my miscarriage coat, which I still have, I will never give away, and I probably will never wear. Because every time I wear it, there's just too many memories associated with it. There's the archetype healer, which is Hesco, the Greek goddess of healing wounds and curing illness. Now, how could you use that? If I was to do guided imagery with you, I might offer that image if that was comfortable to you. Again, if you come from a Christian-based religion and that's not comfortable, there's a lot of other types of healing metaphors you could use that are more comfortable. I might have you just explore those feelings through imagery because a lot of this process doesn't have to be discussed. It's just in the making of it that the process happens. It's not like you have to talk about it. And I talked about the scar tissue already. Scars provide amazing metaphor. We learn, we grow, we get hurt, we must learn to defend ourselves. Some of the responses to injury is excessive. So making the shawl can metaphorically transform the image of a scar into one of healing. So again, it's through this process of the making. This is a house that I made, and you don't want to try to analyze my mind, you know what that means about this house. Again, this is all made from felt. And I had attended a workshop about 5 years ago with somebody who had taught us how to make this type of felt, and there's a lot of skills that we learned in terms of making the felt this way. We actually got to weld and make a metal frame for it. But the issue was more, for me, the house, and who am I? What does that mean in my own house? So the house was a really good example. And part of it, and this is a theme of a lot of my work, just because it's personal, but it doesn't have anything to do with what you would want to explore. But I had 5 years of infertility, and then got pregnant within 1 year with twins, and then had a surprise a year later, who I love. It was extremely stressful. I was very overwhelmed, and I'm only gender 12 and 11 now. I'm only just beginning to be less overwhelmed by it. But there was no time to ever deal with infertility. And to go from a person who had her life and just the insanity of fertility treatments and the impact it had on my marriage, and then to raising kids, there was no sympathy. There was no anybody wanted to talk to me about what that was like. So now I've found that in my work, I'm going back and I'm thinking about that and trying to just give myself space to process it. And so that's why there's all these babies and stuff, and you know, it's kind of part of my images of what I do. This is another good example of a vessel. There's really no reason why I incorporated these little monk pots, except they were colorful and I liked them. But this vessel was purposely something I made to really symbolize to me my uterus, and the whole process of making this useless vessel that I really like this. But it's not something that I really care if anybody were to buy again or see. It's just personal. That whole process was just a really neat process for me to explore that. I'm beginning to let it go, but there were many years where I didn't have time to think about it or I really wasn't sure how to process it. This is another one that I call biological clock destroying. Motherboard's biological clock is driving me crazy. Somebody pushed me into doing a design competition and then I chickened out and never submitted it. But again, I incorporated ceramics and doilies and with basketry, and these are little walnuts, so it's driving me crazy. But again, one of the things I'll talk about here in a minute is when I talk to artists, one of the biggest differences between people who allow themselves to be called artists versus most people who call themselves handcrafters or knitters or weavers is they consciously use metaphors in their work and they stay with the theme. So for me right now, the theme has been exploring what it meant for me, the infernal, and trying to deal with it, as well as the craziness of having children. This was part of the same piece. So it's ceramics, but I use textiles to get the impression on there. So for me, it still involves a lot of textiles and basketry, and a lot of babies running around. What's that?
That's exactly how I felt when I was raising my voice.
Oh, that's crazy. Yeah, so see, it doesn't have to be explained to understand. So is this book for the everyday handcrafter? I think that it is, because when I wrote this book, I knew I wanted it published by an art therapy publishing house. So I picked a really, really good one. And I know, because there was nothing out there in art therapy on using textiles this way, it's just on using paper, pencil, kind of visual arts. But I wrote it for the everyday person, as well as for the everyday person who does workshops. Because, I don't think I have this in here, but because I'm really aware when I go take classes, and that's how I've learned all the things I've learned, that every time I take classes, there's always people in there that are having issues, and I'm hiding, because I'm like a psychologist, but I want to just be there and show them my workshop and not let them know that. But the other side of this, I feel really bad for the teachers, because there's a lot of things that I know as a psychologist about what I would do with those people that are having issues in the class in running a group. So I definitely like have a section here, for example, on groups. What are the dynamics of groups? How do you deal with groups when you have difficult people in groups? And so I was really aware of that when I was writing the book, to think about who is my audience really. It's really a lot of people like myself and like you. So I would say if you decide to get the book, I would say pick and choose what you read. And there's probably two technical chapters on there that talk about the women's mental health issues, what they are, as well as how I would suggest assessing and diagnosing. Because I felt like that had to be in a book on art therapy. I would say skip over it, although several of my friends who love me, so who knows whether they're telling me the truth, have really enjoyed reading the psychological chapters because it gets at things like the sexualization of girls. I talk about all of these issues that are women's issues, and our culture has sexualized girls in a way that is very just terrible for them. It's having a big impact on their self-esteem and depression later on. And so some of that might just be interesting, but it may get more technical. There's chapters on groups, learning how to use expressive writing, learning how to use imagery, if you want to, and if you want to skip it, I'll understand that. And exploring the meaning behind what you make. Like I said earlier, color choice, materials. Think about ways to expand what you do so that you're not just making the same things all the time. And my suggestions are in the handout that you have there, which is, first of all, don't stay within the lines. Now, I think this is one of the things that most people do, like when you learn to knit, it's really typical to go ahead and follow patterns, and you can do that for years. But once you learn modular knitting, for example, what says you can't just start to do it on your own and make up your own patterns? And that can be really freeing to try to just do something without a pattern and really push yourself. Now, I hear a lot of people tell me, you know, I can't do that, or I'm not that good at it. Well, I guess yes, you can, and just that issue of thinking you can't is something that you should challenge, because that idea in and of itself is a limitation that maybe is preventing you from finding other expressive outlets for yourself. No more after you. That's just one of my little things that has been really hard, big things as a mother, which is, you know, I just, like, always, everybody comes first, and that's rewarded in society for us to be really good caretakers and to do a really good job of meeting other people's needs. So can you give yourself permission to just go do something because it feels good? And it's taken me years to be able to do that, but I do it. Because my husband knows now that if I say I need to go work in my studio and for 4 hours, it's probably a good thing to let me go do that. Because I will be in a better mood afterwards. But those are the kind of things, like giving yourself permission to do that. Incorporate metaphors consciously into your work. And I do talk about this in one of the chapters. When I interview these artists, I ask them, do you consciously use metaphors? And the majority said yes. And when I ask my craft makers, do you incorporate metaphors? That's, huh? I don't know. I've never really thought about it. And that's where I think that you can do that. as well as think about what you're already making and what it reflects. The other difference between artists and us handcrafters is making multiple pieces on the same theme. And so we'll have series. So they naturally get to work through their issues as they do their series. There's some pictures I'll show you of some really strange textile artists in the book, but that have worked through a lot of issues like that. So I've been doing it in different media and just challenging myself to continue to work through. You know, yes, I'm now almost at about menopause and I have three children, but fertility issues were a big deal for my life in my 30s. What did one sheep say to the other after you? and then the other thing is enjoy yourself. Again, I think that regardless of all the stuff I'm talking about in the book, if nothing else today, my research just acknowledges what everybody, what Ellen came in here saying. What did you say about it?
Well, permission.
Yeah, who needs we don't really need permission anymore, but I'm giving you permission to enjoy yourself. I think that it's a good thing that we have this, and it's a good outlet. I didn't really speak to this as much, but there has been a huge regeneration of interest in handcrafts in the last 10 or 15 years. I could talk about that a lot more, and I probably won't. But I can say that I think part of it, yes, it had to do with the decline from the Industrial Revolution. I think that feminist movement and, you know, I'm a feminist and I support a lot of feminist ideas. I teach a class in women's studies at the university. But I think there was a real view that making handcrafts was an example of oppressing women. And it just became like, ew, you do that, isn't that just so stereotypical female? And I think that there was a real pushing away from that for a long time. And I was making stuff, even when it wasn't cool to make stuff, even when my fellow classmates in graduate school were just kind of rolling their eyes at me for wanting to knit and weave because I loved it. But I think now, in the last 10 years, it's very cool to do all this stuff. And knitting has been popularized through movie stars making things. We have a real do-it-yourself movement that's happened. So there's been a whole kind of, and there's been a real interest again in ways for people to connect with one another. So I think that there's a lot of societal things as well as maybe this whole third wave of feminism has come back to say, well, we're good at it, it's okay, we do it. Who knows? But regardless, the most important thing to me in all of this is because it feels good and my research actually just verifies that. Okay, so I had a lot of women artists, and this is one of them, because it's just a very strange series of work she's done. This one was all on wigs. But one of the ideas I incorporated into the book was, you know what, if you have cancer or somebody you know has cancer, what about making some really strange hand-spun yarn and make it into some really funny, strange types of hats to wear? And the whole idea is that, you know, we could bring humor to the situation, we can make light of it. Now she does this, for whatever reason, I think some of her pieces are a little scary, but that also is really interesting because it's challenging. It challenges us to think, oh, what are we doing with these wigs? She's got some really strange ones that I didn't include. This is another artist that I love, and her name is Netta Amir. She's out of Israel, she's a doll maker. And again, doll making is just one of those things that you could make, if you like to make dolls, they are also sculptures. And they can be sculptures that can be very expressive. And Netta uses recycled materials, and that's something that I'll just close with here in a minute or two, but the use of recycled materials captures so many metaphors in our lives in terms of things that have been used by people as well as people that weren't acknowledged. So this really, this piece says a lot. I don't really have to say a lot for it, but a lot of her works are just like, they're not beautiful, and do they have to be beautiful? No, just like my piece with Hestia, but they're very expressive. This is another piece called Femme Fat Owls that one of the artists in the book has, celebrating women of all sizes. I just felt like I had to put something in there because, again, that is a really, really big issue. There's this article on objectifications, was on CNN, if any of you want to look for it, which is just about how we continue to objectify women and that affects our self-esteem. This is called My Lady of Creativity. This is another quilt maker who's working with it. And again, so the images, the metaphors can be from Judeo-Christian religions. It doesn't have to be from things we can't relate to. So just to close with this whole issue of these unnamed women throughout the ages in our families, can we memorialize these anonymous people? Can we as women see our work as art? How many of you, I know how many of you said you made handcrafts, how many of you would say you're artists? I'm proud to know there are some artists in here. I bet that there's people you're sitting next to who make exquisitely beautiful things, but they don't call themselves artists. And that's something that's really been surprising to me as I've taken these workshops through the years, people who are taking workshops just because they love to do that, but they are amazing at their craft, but they won't call themselves artists. But can we acknowledge that? See, have somebody in here who's done it for that. There's a lot of people like that, and I don't profess to be an artist in any other reason than to say I want to acknowledge that my work's important and it can be beautiful, but I don't need to be written up as an artist. But I think there's artists everywhere. It's not just people who are professionally trained. This is a piece that a woman, I met some really amazing women when I first did a research study that contacted me. These are all trash bags from the New York Times, comes in these blue plastic bags. And so she kept them, and she purposely wanted to use materials that were discarded, which is what she felt happened to women as they get older and less attractive and past their prime in their childbearing years. And so she's made a series of garments by knitting together these trash bags. And I just think that's amazing. This was one of the artists who had the dolls in the beginning. This is called Picking the Blues. Again, she purposely uses cotton as well as discarded doilies because it's her way of memorializing people. This is a piece I made recently that has antique lace that I found, and I felted it in, so it's actually part of the scarf. And actually, this here has some antique lace on it as well, but you can't really tell because it's black, so it doesn't show up as much. So this is my piece that I did, and I decided not to wear it. I've been wearing it a few times. I've been doing these talks, but that's me. But this is the doilies, and it's my way of incorporating doilies into my felting process. Again, as a way to symbolically acknowledge people. Felt piece I have, the namaste. I thank you for coming, for listening to what I have to say. I hopefully spark some ideas. And I guess we can take a few minutes for questions. Yeah.
Could you say something about this article? I did make enough copies for everybody.
My publisher's website had an e-interview, and there are not enough copies to go around, but if you were to... Oh, there are now? Okay. And so it probably captures a lot of the things I've talked about, but you know, some of it in more depth, some are going to be the same, but just about how I got into this, what I'm trying to accomplish with the book, and what the book is about. Yes,
questions? What's the metaphor for that
decision? What do you think the metaphor is? How many people here have many projects that are not finished? So feel like you're not alone. You know, I think that's part of it. I think that, you know, there's going to be times when you finish things, right, and times when you don't. I have yarn that I've had for 15, 20 years. When I left New Zealand, somewhere in my mind it was like I was never going to have wool robing again, and it was cheap, so I bought more robing than I ever needed to bring back with me. And then it sits there for so long, it's just like a, you know, favorite thing in my house, so I don't need to do anything with it anymore. It's just part of my own. So maybe it doesn't need to be finished. Maybe it's just there. So I just think we all have that. Yeah?
First, thank you. This has been really interesting, and your work is beautiful and very moving. And thank you for sharing your stories behind them. I'm wondering about, in your research, if you found anything, and I don't know if you asked questions on this, or perhaps. Didn't. But a lot of the work that I do, my projects become what I call Effenheimer projects, because something goes wrong and it stresses me out. So actually, while it does perhaps make my mood ultimately feel better, there are many moments where, I mean, there was once, it's a joke in our family now, where I actually threw the yarn into the fire. Because I was so fed up with trying to unravel it and it wasn't working. And part of that's my inability to deal with stress, probably, is what my therapist would say. But did you get any questions?
You are dealing with it by just
did you get questions of when the art actually does the opposite of what we've been talking about. It actually does stress you out.
People did talk to that too, that it can be stressful. And the artist talked to me about that too, that even though they said metaphorically, their work did show metaphors, sometimes they couldn't see it until they were like halfway through or even like finished, and then they realized something had happened and then they applied it again. So I think that that's not an unusual experience. I think that the more experienced you are in a specific technique, the less that happens because you know what to do.
Right.
And so that's why I won't do certain things. Like I started making these bunch of tile projects for kids in my church, and then I ended up doing a bunch on my own, and then I started this really big project at home, and it's way over my head, and it's been there for 3 or 4 years now. It's not done because it stresses me out, and it's not fulfilling to go do it. So I think that there's a lot of truth to that, and that's part of what either working through it or realizing it's time to put that away and go to one of the others you have left behind and go back to it later. And I do think your process, though, is really important to look at, because I think that's part of this process of how we make things that you can understand. You know, maybe you want to throw the kitchen, that's terrible. Maybe you want to throw something out of the house, but you can't do that. But you can do that with your yard. So, I mean, I think that happens to me all the time, and that's why people said it's not just a bowl of cherries going out and making things, but at the same time, staying with it and finishing it. I think for me, the biggest thing that happens when I make something is that I have a sense of control, and I control the piece of my life, and now I have something beautiful. You know, and I got through it, and, you know, that's part of it, is I have part of my world I can master at that time, and I can finish it eventually. Yeah.
Have you found in your research that there are particular ages or stages in women's lives when handcrafts are more important to them?
Oh, that's a really good question. I don't know that I'd asked it that way. The sample size, the people that I talked to were on average about 45 to 50 years of age, which means that looking out here, a lot of the people tend to be older to get into it, and I think that it's because you have years and years of experience, and then that allows you more time to use it that way as you get older. But I do think people talked a lot about different activities and different times in their lives and why. I asked them why they changed. And part of it was everything from I upsized to I downsized to, like, I started a knit when my kids were, I needed to take a small project with me everywhere I went, and I couldn't take my loom anymore all around the world. So I think there's different times that we will pick up different types of activities. Does that answer your question? So I think that it does vary throughout people's lives, and I asked it a little bit more directly. Other questions? Yes,
as an everyday person, I just like to give a testimonial for the book that I I think it's
She's my student, though.
I wasn't planning, but I really do feel that it's very interesting to read as a non-professional and actually as a non-textile artist.
So it wasn't too complicated?
Absolutely not. I think it's very fascinating.
There's a real variety of things that I cover in the book that have to do with textiles. Yeah.
When is your presentation at the University?
I believe it's April 21st. And then for that one, you would need to call just Secretary Chris Simpson and about signing up for that one. Because that's a workshop instead of a presentation. There's a more limited number. But I am going to put some things on the calendar here this summer, and so if you're interested in knowing if I have other workshops coming up, feel free to sign up.
What do you mean by workshop?
Well, like the workshop I'm doing at Unitarian is just as a group, we're going to be exploring making a shawl, and it can be out of any material. It doesn't have to be felting. It could be taking t-shirts that are meaningful from your family's life. It could be using knitting, things that your preferred medium. But we're going to talk about how you can use that material and imagery and writing to explore in more depth.